So we have extraordinary guest today. As you know, World Bank wrote this book, Fighting Corruption in Georgia. Asad Alam is one of the authors of this book and the person who decided that book needed to be written. And I don't know for which reason I was asked to say also some words, because I think it's better if he will tell from his view of what. Because his view of newcomer who come to Georgia after most of the reforms were happened, and who was analyzing Georgia as a scientist. And my view is about, as a real person who was in Georgian government and for 5 years serving Georgia as minister and head of chancellery. And my view is a little bit different, not about outcomes, but about how and why we were that doing. But I think that it's better if we refer this to question and answers. Maybe I can, in some cases, clarify some of the things if there is an interest. And now, floor is yours, please.
Thanks, Kaha. And I think it's easier for me to stand and talk. And hopefully, the microphone will be able to.
Okay.
Is this better? Okay. Anyway, good evening to everyone, and it's a real pleasure to be here. I think the last time I was here at the university was maybe 2 years ago, talking to a group of graduating students. So I'm happy to be here and present to you our recent publication on Georgia. And as Kaha very rightly said, it's a perspective, at least for me, it's a perspective of someone who comes in from outside and looks at Georgia and tries to understand how Georgia was able to make such major strides in fighting corruption and in public services over a relatively short period of time. But the book is more than that, and let me try to explain to you what the objective of the book was. You know, in many countries of the world, especially in emerging markets, developing countries that are trying to modernize, corruption is a big problem. And you have a lot of stories of countries that have problems with corruption in their public services and in various other institutions in government. And it's very difficult to get an example of a good story. And to us, when I came here and started looking at things, you know, Georgia provided a very refreshing perspective on how things can be improved and how corruption, this notion that corruption is culture and that many countries and many governments use as an excuse not to fight corruption, this notion that corruption is culture, you know, has been broken. This notion, this myth has been destroyed in Georgia. And I think we'll talk about that. And it is really a very strong message on that. But we wanted to go beyond just chronicling what happened in Georgia to actually understanding how these anti-corruption reforms were done. And for that, what we did was we adopted a very serious objective framework for analysis. We modeled our analysis on the Harvard Business case study, where we looked at a certain set of sectors. So we chose 8 sectors where successful reforms had been undertaken: the patrol police, power supply, tax, customs, business regulation, public and civil registry, university entrance examination, and municipal services. We chose these 8 sectors, and they don't cover the whole economy, obviously, and we did not select some sectors where things have not gone as well as could have happened. So we adopted a case study approach. Each case study is structured in 3 parts: the state of affairs in 2003, and it would be interesting for me also to see, I mean, I'm sure many of you will recognize in our description things that you have lived through and witnessed. Maybe some of you were too young at that time. Then we try to document the post-2003 anti-corruption reforms. And we are careful in not talking about the broader economic reforms. In Georgia's case, the anti-corruption reforms were embedded, of course, in the broader set of economic and social and political reforms that the country undertook. But we are here talking only about the anti-corruption reforms, and we try to be particular about that. and then we try to document the results from these reforms. In order to get to the hub of the story, we had a series of very structured interviews with senior policymakers, you know, to ask them what were the trade-offs, what was going on in their mind, why did they pick one particular reform before the other, what were the threats that they faced in the implementation of these reforms, how did they overcome the capacity constraints within the government. Some very specific questions on the how-to of reforms, because the whole idea of this book is to try to make it useful for people in other countries, policymakers who might also be trying to fight corruption in their public services. And finally, we use a framework that came out first in the World Development Report of 2004, and as some of you might know, the World Development Report series is an annual publication of the World Bank, a flagship publication that focuses on one particular topic. In 2004, it focused on the role on making public services work for the poor. And it had a very nice framework on accountability arrangements, which are important in order to ensure the sustainability of the reforms. So we applied that framework also on the Georgian story to see to what extent these reforms are indeed sustainable. So let me try to put some aggregative numbers first, and you will see some aggregative scorecard between what was the situation in 2003 and how things improved by 2010-11. Some of you must be familiar with it. These are all public data from Transparency International, from the rank again of Georgia in the Corruption Perception Index, the Doing Business Report, and it's always there in the recent copy of The Economist also. There's a whole page advert on why people should do business in Georgia, which includes this number on Georgia being the best reformer in the world, and the various other indicators. We also undertook a very special survey. This is a survey that was done jointly with EBRD in 2010, where we asked respondents, and about 1,000 people were polled in Georgia, a nationally representative sample, not only in Georgia, but across the whole of the Europe and Central Asia space. And we asked them very specific questions about on whether the person had actually paid a bribe in the previous 12 months. And this question was asked specifically in the education sector, in road police, in accessing official documents like birth certificates and various other documents that you might need from a public registry or civil registry, on access to social unemployment benefits, as well as on civil courts. And when you look at the top row, the indicators for Georgia, you see that the numbers for Georgia are very similar or closest to the numbers for the EU5 than they are to the numbers of the former Soviet Union, which is really the parent group for comparison. In some instances, like for instance on road police or access to official documents, these numbers are even better than those of the new member states, which would be countries like Slovakia and the Baltic states and Hungary and Poland, etc. So, you know, Georgia, even on the sector-specific aggregative indicators, does quite well. Now, let me go a little bit deeper into each of the case studies and give you first a very brief look and a very quick look at some of the changes that took place between 2003 and 2011. And we have tried to pick only three sets of indicators for each. When you look at the patrol police, for instance, you see significant improvements. In the book, we document stories of how, in order to get a driver's license, people had to pay bribes. It's a common story of, you know, for how a driver's license was used to be a popular birthday gift, and someone didn't have to pay an exam, etc., to get a driver's license. Of the harassment that citizens used to have in order to move even in Tbilisi, where traffic police would stop them arbitrarily and seek a bribe. All of that is actually quite familiar to me also, because I come from India, from a very poor state of India, and I also witnessed some of the problems that Georgia witnessed in 2003. I've also seen that when I was growing up, and it is still there when I visit my home country. And I think, you know, it is by whatever the evidence and the data that is available, I think it is quite clear that many of these problems have now been eliminated or drastically reduced. Tax collections is another important area of improvement. In 2003, many people perceived Georgia as a failed state where the tax collections of the government was so low that the government could not even provide the basic services. And it was not because the taxes were not being collected. Taxes were being collected, but they were not going into the government coffers. They were going into individual pockets. The tax collection rate as a share of GDP was only about 12%, one of the lowest in the world at that time. Now Georgia has one of the most efficient tax collection services. There are some problems, and we all know of some of the problems in tax collection, even in Georgia, because there are always scope for improvement. But the tax, there's a one measure of tax, what is called a tax compliance rate, which is a measure of the effectiveness of tax collection, and Georgia ranks pretty high on that tax compliance rate. So even as Georgia was able to reduce the average rate of taxes, it was able to raise the level of tax collection. And some of the tax collection that was raised early on was done through very aggressive means. And I think in the book we document some of the stories of how tax collections were negotiated with major figures or business people who had been in tax arrears or tax non-compliance for a long time. In one particular instance, one significant businessman, the government negotiated a tax payment of about $12 million, which was equivalent to 1 month's pension arrears. So a lot of the collection of the tax of the taxes was done pretty aggressively and in the early years. The number of taxes, as I mentioned, there's a major program of tax simplification that accompanied the improvement in tax collections. And this is again in economic literature also, when you look at many other countries in Europe at different phases in time, during the Reagan administration in the United States, for instance, also, where people of a certain ideological view in the economics profession felt that the reduction in taxes would lead, and the simplification of the tax regime would lead to an improve in tax collection. Some of you may be familiar with what has also been known as a Laffer curve. In some instances, Georgia's experience shows that a Laffer curve does exist. The evidence on that is mixed from around the world, but in Georgia, there is evidence, at least partial evidence that I see, on the evidence of a Laffer curve. E-filing. In 2003, there was no e-filing in Georgia. But over the last 2 years, actually, I think even as recently as the beginning of 2010, e-filing rates were very low in Georgia. But over the last 2 years, we have now 70 to 80% of tax returns now being filed electronically. What it means by e-filing is that people are able to make the tax payments, submit the tax returns online. It reduces the interface between the citizens and the state. The more you reduce this interface, the more you limit the opportunity for discretionary for bribes to take place or for some discretionary exchange of monies. Customs, again a hotbed of corruption in the early years, and I think you also see some of the numbers here, not only in terms of the bribe to pay a customs official, but also in terms of the complexity of the customs regime with a lot of import tariff bans, relatively high average tariffs, not very high because there had been a lot of tariff reduction in the 1990s also, but a lot of complexities and a lot of loopholes in tax collections, and a lot of bribes changed hands whenever anyone wanted to import anything into the country. I think this is one of the areas where progress initially was the slowest. When I asked President Saakashvili, when we interviewed him for the book, in terms of which was one area where he felt looking back, which was the most difficult to reform, and he told us that it was customs, that he felt that it could not be done. And the customs reform was largely completed only in 2011 with the modernization of some of the customs points into the country. And customs is again one area where things did not go move in a straight line notion, in the sense that even though the changes were, I think the government knew the direction in which it wanted to go, but there was a lot of experimentation, a lot of hits and misses, things were tried and it didn't work, and then corrections were made. So there was a lot of back and forth on the customs reforms, but now it seems that there is some degree of stability now in the customs regime. Power power supply, one of the first things that was done by the government was indeed to actually address the situation of the very poor power supply in the country. In 2003, from what we understand, average service in Tbilisi or even in the whole country was only 7 to 8 hours. There used to be demonstrations in Tbilisi, not so much people were not asking so much for additional power as they wanted to know when will this power supply be so that they could plan, you know, when to cook or when to have other family events. And now, of course, we all live in a country which is not only provides 24/7 power but also exports power to neighboring countries. What was interesting in the power supply, as it is interesting in the other stories also, and this is one of the lessons that we take out from the Georgia experience, is that the reforms were holistic. So when you look at the power sector reforms, it is not only about increasing the collection of rates, the collection rates were very low, again there was a lot of leakage in the system, but also the service quality was improved, generation capacity was expanded. There were new ways of bringing in the private sector into the generation and the distribution of power. So there was a holistic approach actually undertaken to power sector reforms. And if in each of these sectors, I hope you have a chance to read the book or download it or maybe get it from the library. I'm sure you will have several copies of it in the library now. You will see that holistic reforms in each of the sectors was an important part of the Georgian story. The deregulation of business, this is something that Kaha himself has been very closely associated with. I think this has been a unique feature of the Georgian reforms. I don't think there's any country which has addressed the issue of deregulating businesses as aggressively and with as much success as Georgia has had. And it requires a lot of political will. In all of these reforms, one of the underlying themes is really strong political will. Many countries have tried to introduce a guillotine approach, a review of their regulatory frameworks, a review, functional reviews of line agencies to try to see which agency should exist, which agency should be eliminated. But those reviews very seldom make success and lead to significant results. But here we had a situation where Kaha, when he was the Minister of Economy at that time, along with a couple of colleagues, used to have a series of very meetings with all agencies, agency heads, where they had to come and explain to the group on why they should not be eliminated. I think the burden for them was to prove that they served a useful purpose and that they should continue to exist. And then recommendations were made from this group to the cabinet of ministers, to the prime minister and his team, and decisions were taken in, on which agencies should exist and which should be culled. Maybe Georgia went too far in terms of trying to eliminate a lot of other agencies which many in Western Europe would consider to be standard parts of their public service architecture. But there was a notion that underpinned all of these reforms, which was explained to me by Kaha himself, and that was that the capacity of the state to deliver a service has to really be linked to the existence of an institution. So if an institution was not serving a purpose, or if the capacity of the state was not there to regulate that institution, then that institution did not, was not a viable institution. As Georgian capacity of the state has improved over the last few years, we see some of these institutions now coming back in a smarter way to try to perform that public service. Public and civil registries, I think this is one of another area in which we believe that there was phenomenal improvements in terms of providing a service to the population. We work in across many countries, and I don't know how many of you have recently accessed any of the new public service halls, these in Rustavi or in there's one in Batumi, in Kutaisi, in Batumi, where under one roof there are something like 245 public services being offered. It's like a single window where you can actually go, and I'm sure some of you must have done the transactions. But when we went there to actually check it out, I think it was a revelation that so many different services could be actually offered under a single roof. Now, of course, there is a cost recovery element there, but there used to be cost recovery in the past also when services, you know, when you had to pay a bribe to get your passport, for instance. Now you have to pay a fee to get your passport, but you know that you can get your passport, you get a text message on your cell phone that the passport is available for pickup at a certain point and at a certain time the following day or a week based upon the option that you choose. There are many European countries which have tried to integrate various public services, but I have not seen any example where there are so many services that are offered simultaneously in a single space. Nor have I seen an example where the way that it is done in Georgia, in terms that the government takes a responsibility for providing a lot of the background checks and documentation that is needed. Last year, my son is in the US and I had to apply for US passport for him. And I had to go through several agencies and I had to produce each and every single original documentation to actually show that he's a US citizen and has a social security card and birth certificate. And it took me 3 weeks to get the passport in the mail. Here, all you need, for those of you who have gone through the system, is the passport application and a small picture. And the responsibility is of the state of trying to get the birth certificate and making sure that the marriage certificate is right, etc. All the other background documentation they need. And that is because the systems are all integrated. All the other systems have been put on an electronic platform and they are integrated. University entrance exams, obviously this is something that all of you must have gone through in order to get to free university. In 2003, different universities had their own entrance examinations. They had to have different bribes based upon who you knew. And the system obviously favored those who were well-connected and those who were rich, those who were in Tbilisi, for instance. And did not favor and was biased against those who came in from other parts of the country. Since over the last few years, of course, this has been a major dramatic improvement. Now, we know that the university entrance exam itself has been changing, but the principle of having a clean university entrance examination, and you all know the system, and I'm not going to go through it, of how it is all monitored in a very electronic manner, and how your results are actually provided to you after you have completed your examination. I think this is something that it speaks a lot for the transparency of the university entrance examination system. Municipal services tells you a similar story, and this is largely about water, similar to the story that we had about the power sector in terms of the improvements in public service delivery, that was accompanied by increases in tax collection rates, in the collection rates as well as in the charges that consumers have to pay. So having gone through these case studies, what emerges in terms of some of the ingredients for Georgia's success? And what I want to be clear about is that what we are trying to distill here are what worked for Georgia, what were the success factors for Georgia. We are not saying here that these are all the success factors that every country in the world should adopt and these are the lessons, should be the holy grail for fighting corruption in every single country. That is not the message here. The message is, this is what worked for Georgia, and then we leave it for every country, whoever is wants to learn from it, to figure out what may work in their own country context. And let me go through each one of these in a little bit of detail, just to give you a flavor of how we come about to these conclusions. Exercising strong political will. Now, some of you might say, this is motherhood and apple pie. You know, of course we know that without strong political will, nothing will happen. It's stating the obvious, and which is absolutely true. But we state the obvious because there are so many countries who can't even get the obvious right, can't even get the basics right. And in Georgia's case, I think you have had a consistent exercise of that strong political will, starting from the president and through the leadership and through a strong emphasis on Georgia without corruption. Now, of course, it is true that with a post-revolutionary government, with the 90% popular support in the elections, it is easier to accomplish and show that political will. But I think there was also more to it than that. there was a strong sense of urgency among the policy makers, and through our interviews we get that sense of urgency very clearly, that they had a short window of opportunity within which to act and to show results. I think the second message that we come through in terms of one of the success factors is really on the role of credibility, of establishing the credibility of a reform process very early on. The zero tolerance for corruption was an important part of that, and that was established really by destroying many of the symbols of corruption very early. You know, there was this situation, and Kaka knows this better than I do, of where parliamentarians had immunity from prosecution. And in fact, parliamentarians who were well connected and who were in 2003, where people suspected them of corrupt practices, in order to even initiate an inquiry against them, there had to be a parliamentary approval process, which was very difficult to get. There was a small change in the law that was made after the Rose Revolution, where it was made permissible for an investigation to be started against a parliamentarian, but it was still a requirement to actually bring to the vote in parliament the formal charge of indictment. So the indictment still needed parliamentary approval, but the investigation could be started without parliamentary approval. Now, this seemingly innocuous change in procedure was very powerful, because it meant that once a body of evidence was collected and brought to the floor of parliament, it became very difficult for other parliamentarians then to deny and not to permit proceedings to take place. When you also look at a lot of the people who were indicted, both in parliament, outside of parliament, government officials, senior government officials, senior very prominent business people, and we document some of those stories here, you know, I think it sent a very strong message out to the whole population that there was a zero tolerance for corruption, that the rules of the game had changed. The other point that I want you to note is really this, what we call the virtuous reform cycle. You know, in the literature, especially on the literature of transition in many of these countries, there is this notion that a country or a new government that might come in has a 100-day window of opportunity. This is something that Laszek Balcerowicz, the former Prime Minister and Governor of the Central Bank of Poland, actually had first introduced, that there was a 100-day window of opportunity. What is striking in the Georgian case is that I think this window of opportunity got replenished every so often through this cycle, this virtuous reform cycle that we actually have on the screen here, where political will, a flexible strategy, a pragmatic design, rapid implementation, and quick results help to replenish this window. And I think that is very important. In fact, it is one of, you know, for me at least personally, it is a lesson that, you know, the political economy of reforms is as important as actually undertaking the very specific reform measures that might be contemplated. Undertaking a frontal assault. Very often in many countries we find that governments are trying to attack corruption or address corruption in a piecemeal fashion. What we find in Georgia's case is that in every sector in which the reform efforts took place, there was a holistic approach to fighting corruption. And I think the Georgian evidence suggests that a holistic approach is actually very important. Even when you look at the sequencing of the reform efforts, the first order of business for the government was really to establish the rule of law and to really get the police reforms underway. So in 2004, the first act of government was really to address the patrol police reforms. But at the same time, the second most important thing for them to do was to try to restore the credibility of the state and to get the tax collections going. And there was a very clear sequencing there. The third thing that they wanted to do and that they were able to demonstrate was really on the power sector reforms, because that was one area where the benefits of the reforms could be brought to a large population, to the whole country, and in a relatively short period of time. The costs of the reform were there. I think there were a lot of vested interests. There were physical investments that were needed. But there was a clear sequencing of how these reforms should be done in order to generate a broader public support for the reform effort. Now, some of this sequencing and some of the strategy involved in this sequencing may not have been as clear why the reforms were being done. So we, of course, have the benefit of hindsight, and this is what sometimes, you know, it's helpful to look back and see what happened. But there is a clear picture that emerges of how this sequencing was actually implemented. Very often we hear stories in different countries of how, you know, corruption cannot be fought because, you know, everyone has been beholden to the system, that the staff don't have the capacity to fight corruption, they don't have the resources, etc. And that then becomes an excuse for not fighting corruption. And we asked in our interviews, how did Georgia was able to overcome the staffing constraint? And I think there's a lot of new blood that came in. The Prime Minister of Georgia's story is quite instructive. He was in the private sector and he was brought in by the then Prime Minister. He got a phone call to come and present his views on power sector reforms. At the end of that meeting, he was offered a position as the Minister of Energy. He had no experience in government. He was not part of the ruling party. He was not a card-carrying member. And he was pretty much an independent private sector person. I think Aha himself told me his story of how he, when he was on his visit and having discussions with the government, I think the question was popped to you on whether you would want to be the Minister of Economy. And I think, you know, you probably paused momentarily and said yes. So there was a lot of new people, people without any connections to party or to key members of the national movement who came into government. And I think this new entry, this new blood was at every level. Whether it was the new police force with young people with very basic qualifications that were hired, or it was at the high levels of the government also. Attractive and motivating new people, of course, was a challenge. And I'll talk a little bit about how Georgia was able to overcome some of those challenges also. The role of the state, and I'm sure in your lectures at Free University, you get a good dose of how the role of the state should be limited in the economy. I think from anyone who has had any interaction with Kafa, that is very clear. And I think that is very important, because you had a situation where the role of the state was excessive and some rebalancing, in fact a drastic rebalancing, was absolutely needed. We talked earlier about the guillotine approach and the balancing the institutional development with the capacity of the state to actually deliver. But this is, you know, the role of the state is now a very contentious issue across the world, you know, given the global economic crisis from the US to Europe to China to India to, of course, this part of the world. It's an evolving state, and there are strong views on what the role of the state in different parts of the economy should be. But one thing is clear, that limiting the interface between the citizen and the state to a minimum really helps clean up the opportunities for corruption. The adoption of unconventional methods. This is something controversial, and it has been applied in Georgia in different ways, and we are trying to capture Georgia's story here. You know, as a development practitioner, as an economist, we all tend to advise the first best solutions to everything. And it is very difficult to go into a second best or a third best, because that then becomes very complicated and raises a lot of questions of political economy. Georgia developed its own unconventional solutions to fighting corruption. For instance, we mentioned earlier, when they were trying to attract new people into the government. In order to attract them, they had to pay better salaries. But the state was completely broke, they didn't have money. So they set up a special fund to top up the salaries of government officials in key services like the prosecutor's office or in selected government ministries, to actually top up their salaries. This was a fund that was supported by the Soros Foundation, by George Soros, also by UNDP, by the Swedish International Development Agency, if I'm not mistaken. It was controversial at that time, because normally one would like to recommend systemic public administration reform that might take 10 years and nothing might come out of it at the end of it. But in Georgia's case, they had a very special fund with a very specific purpose. They kept it in motion for 18 months. It served its purpose, then it was rolled into the budget and unified with the budget. I think that is one example of an unconventional method. Similarly, in fighting crime and punishment, and I think all of you are familiar with the story of the criminals, the thieves in law, and the nexus between established criminal groups, the police and people in government, and how they were running the country in the around 2003 or even in the earlier parts of that. Breaking that nexus required a lot of tough measures, sometimes what we call unconventional, and at least in Georgia's case, that delivered the results. A lot of the early effort was, of course, on prosecutions, and it was a very a tough and a hard-nosed state that actually went about to try to get the results that it sought. Unity of purpose, and within the group that was actually responsible for decision making was very clear. This did not mean that there were no debates in government. We know and we document some evidence in the book also of how there was a richness of debate and discussion in government, everything from privatization strategy to strategies for various other reforms. But at the end of the day, there was a collective decision that was taken and implemented. There were very selective high-level commissions that were formed at different points in time to focus on specific areas, for instance, education and the power sector, and these commissions were very often led by the Prime Minister at that time, who was Mr. Zwania. International experience has been a very important part of Georgia's story. Not so much that they have copied directly from what was implemented or was the experience from abroad, but I think what we find is a very active adaptation of that international experience to Georgia's own conditions. For instance, on the anti-mafia legislation, there was a lot that was borrowed from the US, from the Italian anti-mafia legislation, and tailored to Georgia's specific conditions. And you will find various other examples here on that. There were a lot of study tours that Georgian policymakers actually took to various other countries to look at experiences and learn from it. This is my favorite bit, and which is the use of technology to actually provide these public services. I had not expected, you know, when we launched this book, that technology would have played such an important role in the delivery of public services. Whether it is in the social security, the social safety net provision, the social services that are provided, the business and service, civil service registry, in the tax system, in customs, technology has been an important part of Georgia's efforts to try to make systems in government systems transparent and to simplify it. Communications has been a little bit of a difficult challenge for Georgia, but I think there are two aspects of the communications. One aspect, which is the strategic communication of trying to demonstrate that that the world is different, that the rules of the game are different, that there is equality before the law. So towards that end, you had a lot of public arrests of people and of tax evaders, for instance, and that were seen live on television, and you may remember some of those stories. But there was a second part of the strategic communications, which was really to try to inform the people of about the reform efforts itself and what was needed and why things were being done in a particular manner. That was not done as systematically. Looking back, I think there were some instances where the communication effort was short of what could have been done. But over the last two or three years, you see a much more vigorous effort at communicating the economic reforms and strategies to the population. The role of the media to expose the cases of corruption and publicize important actions has really been helpful in changing the mindset of the population. And let me turn briefly now to the accountability framework and to the future agenda, which as citizens of Georgia, which almost all of you, I presume, are, I think, should be of interest to you. What we try to look at is the relationship between the government, the providers of service, and the citizens. And one of the things that we find is really that relationship is dependent upon the strength of institutions. And now you might say again that that is obvious. You need strong institutions if you want to sustain any reform. And the question we ask is that, does Georgia have the right balance between the prosecutorial actions, which have been an important part of the fight against corruption, and the institutional development? When I started writing this book, I had my priors were that institutions were very weak. I have changed my priors since then. I think there has been a lot of on institutional development that has taken place, but I think there's still some ways to go. And in particular, I think there is a scope for strengthening the system of checks and balances on executive power, which would be essential for the sustainability of the reforms. This means that the whole set of institutions that is related to the parliament, to strengthening the parliament, to strengthening the judiciary, to the chamber of control, to various public organs, but also the checks and balances that come through civil society and through media. So I think there's a whole broad set of public institutions that are important for any democratic setup which needs further development. And this is something that I think, you know, most of us would agree, as Georgia is on a path of transition in many dimensions. Are Georgia's reforms replicable to other countries? Many of you might say, well, Georgia had a very unique post-revolutionary experience, and therefore this is a very unique situation. Our answer is that yes, many of the reforms are indeed replicable. Maybe the full set of what Georgia did may not be replicable to other countries, but many of the things that Georgia did, deregulation for instance, you don't need a revolution to do to undertake deregulatory reforms, and many other countries have done that. The use of technology to improve public services, many countries have done that. So I think in many areas there can be a significant improvement, but of course it requires political will. Nothing moves if you don't have political will. So I think with that I want to thank you and would be happy to take your questions.
Please, questions.
Thank you for an informative presentation, first of all. So just one question. You started by statements that you've chosen 8 most prolific cases of reform. Now the question obviously is risen here. So are those also the most meaningful, or they were chosen simply by the mere fact that these areas of reform were the most successful, or in any country or state actually which implements reforms in these particular 8 areas, it's bound to be
with the choice of the sectors. So that was one of the dominant reasons why we chose these particular reforms. I remember Kaha advising me very strongly to also look at agriculture, because he felt that the elimination of agricultural subsidies was a major anti-corruption effort. But I didn't have good data from alternative sources, one to actually demonstrate how corruption, you know, to capture the index of corruption, of how that that has changed during that period. So there were some other areas which we did not choose because of that. Some areas we did not choose because it was not a success story, that we did not have any evidence to actually demonstrate that. And we really wanted this to be a story about how things can be done. Because, you know, in the world there are a lot of stories about how things cannot be done. So this was meant in some ways as a filter. So we used that also as a filter. So there were multiple filters that we used actually to come to this choice of 8 sectors.
Okay. More questions?
First of all, thank you for such an interesting presentation. Well, I saw an article in Economist, it was written in February, I guess, and it was advertising your book, and then I got interested in your book, and that's very inspiring to me with an author. Well, I'll start with the reforms in public sector. They're truly inspiring in Georgia. For example, if you take a university entrance exams, I personally experienced this, and the fact that I study at this very university and that I'm standing right now here is a positive outcome of that reform. But, and also Economist and CNN broadcast that Georgia is a number first reformer, and they have a special data on the ease of opening a business and anti-corruption matters. But still, I think that there are some problems and there are some big challenges. For example, in agriculture, like 80% of the food what we eat is based on import, and also there is a high rate of unemployment, and that of course matters. President thinks about the model of how can we overcome these challenges, and he thinks that model of Singapore will be the best. But which means massive deregulation, privatization, and free investment as well. But what you want from us is a Baltic States model, which is slightly different from that, and means sort of a regulation and institution building. In your opinion, which will be the best path for our country to choose, and where we should go in that model space? Thank you.
The best path is your own Georgian model. I think, first of all, this book is about anti-corruption, so it's not about broader economic reforms. So what some of your questions are much broader in nature in terms of what should be done on agriculture, etc., you know, how do you reduce unemployment. So those are much broader questions which I think that will take us away from this discussion on anti-corruption. But I think it is a red herring to think about, you know, this model or that model. I think one of the points that we bring out here is that what even on the anti-corruption front, what there were some very uniquely distinctive things that Georgia was able to do. And I think every country needs to make its own choice in terms of the type of economic reforms that it wants and the direction in which it wants to go. But that is a little bit about also about the leadership and the collective vision that all of you have as citizens of the country. What is your vision for your future? I think it is less important what I think is should be your future, but I think what we can share is a vision for a much more prosperous country, where you all, everyone has a much greater equality of opportunity in terms of your living up and fulfilling your own aspirations, and there are different ways to the truth, and so it's something that you have to discover yourself. From international experience, of course, you can follow a lot of very good ideas you can get, which Georgia has done in its fight on corruption also, and try to adapt it to your own particular needs. But if you want to have a broader discussion on agriculture, then I think Kaha is a good guy to actually lead you in that direction.
And actually, the figures are wrong. It's some sort of myth that 80% of what we're eating is imported. It cannot be proved not from macroeconomic data, not from your own experience and each of you. What we are really important, we are importing a lot of meat, that's reality. But otherwise, so the 40 something percent is our consumption of food and of final food. Yeah, so that means that for the primary production wise, it's something like 20% of GDP equal, and 10% is produced by Georgian agriculture, as we know. So this is a very rough estimate. It gives that maybe 50% is imported, and that's good, because I think that if we begin eating only what we can produce in Georgia, it will be quite strange situation. Georgia was never happening in history. That Georgia will be so-called self-sufficient. It's Soviet myth also that the country needs to be self-sufficient. In Soviet time there was so-called a special government task of so-called protein independence. It's difficult to explain for normal people what means protein independence, but the idea was that the total amount of protein produced in the Soviet Union should be enough to satisfy all demand in protein, but Soviet Union was unable to become protein dependent. Of course, I mean, we are a poor country. That's the limitation. We are poor country with unbalanced ego to be a rich country, and I mean, people believe that we can be in 1 or 2 years in the right policy, like Austria or Switzerland. Yeah, when I was a young minister, freshly appointed minister, we go to some TV show. There was a discussion about economics, and then after that there was some deputies, the members of parliament, and they invited me for dinner. And there were members of parliament from opposition and from ruling party. And so we were talking about different things, and one question was raised, and they asked me, what do you think when we can be as rich as European countries? And quite recently before that I was calculating compared to different countries, what can be the pace of our development, compared to the pace of development. And, you know, if you take the richest European country, which is Luxembourg, so the Luxembourg, we can be as Luxembourg in 70 years. Which is, obviously, Luxembourg is very rich, actually. If you take some Slovakia or Poland, it will be much quicker. And then, no, it's impossible, 70 years, we don't have that time, and it's wrong calculation. And how it can be? No. And one member of parliament, which was at that time in ruling party, now it's in opposition, he said, no, it's absolutely wrong. 2 years, maybe 3 years, maximum 4 years, and we'll be like Europe. And I said, no, you see, I had a very exaggerated understanding of their mental capacity. Because they were idiots, as I recognized later, much later, unfortunately. And I told them, okay, you see, it's very simple. So you take the rate of economic growth, for example, 7% of your country, and you take rate of economic growth of other countries, for example, 1% in Luxembourg, long term, and then, so you have 6% difference. It means that you should take 1.06, an order of magnitude of years, which, and they don't hear to the end because they understand it's some very sophisticated mathematics. And they stop shouting, and then they become really serious, so there was a silence, and then one asked me, does President knows about that? So that's revealing that of course it's a top secret that we don't know. And there was a mayor of Tbilisi, for example, who in 2004 said that, okay, I need 3 years, and in 3 years we'll be maybe not as a Vienna, but as a Zurich. I can't understand why he puts Zurich in such a, which is the most expensive city in the world. That place, but that was the feeling. That feeling will, because I mean, you look to audience, you see people who looks like they were sitting in some way in Europe, yeah? And we look to each other and we are not wearing some, I don't know, spears or some items on our noses, and we are not covering us, at least male part not covering our faces, and we look like normal people, yeah? What is so-called normal people, not from normal countries. And because, why, if we are normal people, why we are not living like in Austria or in Switzerland, yeah? And that's, it's so deep in Georgian understanding is that people think that, okay, there should be something wrong why we are here where we are. But of course there is something wrong. That wrong is the complete inability of Georgian nation to build its own own fate and own success during the last 200 years. And unfortunately before that also. And we can dig in past and found how we were making mistakes in 17th century, in 18th century, 19th century, in 20th century. In 19th and 20th century, this was mistakes during without our own will, but before that it was our mistakes. And so for a long time we were from our for our Renaissance, which was in the 12th century, we're going back and back and back and back, and we are there where we should be due to that policies. Yeah, once I was talking with members of parliament, and one asked me, we were talking about economic mistakes, and I tell to one of them, imagine that we have done none of the economic mistakes at all. And suddenly he began thinking, and it takes several minutes, I was afraid what happens, and he says, okay, if we don't make any economic mistakes, never, so the whole world will speak Georgian. Because he was thinking not about the last 20 years, but the last 2,000 years. So we don't make any mistakes last 2,000 years. But unfortunately, we make lots of mistakes, and that's the price we are paying today. And we are continuing to make mistakes, it's unavoidable. Yeah, but I mean, the task is to have to do more right things than mistakes. And in this case, we'll faster, and we'll take our place in, as a developed nation, and you will be still in your mid ages where we will be part of civilized world.
Mr. Alam, you said that you wanted this book to be a success story, and that's perfectly understandable, but is there perhaps any part of the reforms that you might more harshly criticize that you perhaps came across in your research but decided not to include in the book?
There are some areas where, for instance, we know that the judicial reform has lagged, has not proceeded as fast as one would have liked. And the judiciary is an important part of the institutions that fight corruption. So that is why in the end I was saying, making the point that that is an area that needs further strengthening. I would have liked to actually have covered the judicial sector. I didn't have any evidence on the data, but I think it was a more difficult story also to tell, to try to get what the results are. There's a lot of active work now going on in the judicial sector. I think this year also with introduction of the various reforms in the jury system. So, you know, but the judiciary is also much more difficult to change. You can eliminate, you know, you can eliminate a police force, 16,000 policemen, you know, eliminated overnight, and you can train a whole bunch of young people to come in a few months. But it's difficult to transform a judicial system. You know, you need judges, you need a whole body of legal jurisprudence, you need people to go through college and years of education actually to gather that knowledge and then to try to be able to implement it in their practice, in the delivery of their judgments, etc. So I think that is one area where we would have liked to actually have covered it, but we did not because we felt that we didn't have a complete story there.
Everything, they know everything.
So, how many of you do actually remember 2003? You remember the situation, the power blackouts, the, you know, the corruption, the traffic cops stopping you or your parents and asking for a bribe, the problems with university. How many do you actually remember the situation? I did not witness it. But one of the interesting things about this book is that while I was an outsider writing, being part of the team, but many of the other authors, actually some of whom are here, you know, lived through this this period. So many of my co-authors are really Georgian. So I think it was written by people who have actually lived through the through this experience and have witnessed it. So I think it was a personal journey and a personal odyssey actually of actually recounting how the events have actually changed. So, you know, those of you, if you read the book, then I think you'll get more pleasure in terms of trying, because you'll be able to associate remember what things were and how things have changed, and then be your own judge in terms of whether we have actually captured the facts, the factual story properly or not, and whether the conclusions that we draw from those stories are indeed the right ones or not. And you are the best judge and the best critic of whether this is then a truthful rendition of events or not.
So, any ideas?
I would ask you, how could you analyze this fact that new EU member states, those of post-Soviet states, are doing worse than, in some cases, than Georgia, as you have shown those facts. So how could you analyze this fact?
I'm not sure what the answer to that is, honestly. I have not analyzed that. Since I don't know enough about some of those other countries, because you know this is a survey that covers about 35 countries, that it's difficult to actually explain the differences among countries. So I really don't have a complete answer for that. I mean, we were in Geneva recently, and you know, crime rates have increased very sharply in Geneva. People are attributing that to immigration or whatever. So much so that in the brochures that the tourist department of Geneva actually issues, there used to be a statement saying that this is a crime-free city or something like that. Now they've taken it out because they don't want to actually mislead people. So there's a lot of variety of things that affect, you know, local situations. Europe is of course also going through all sorts of other economic problems that also make it more difficult to assure. The survey that we talked about was a survey that was done in 2010 at the peak of the global economic crisis. So that may also have affected some sentiments. You know, but I'm speculating here. I really don't have a good answer to give you on specific differences between the new member states and Georgia.
I just wanted to ask one quick question about those wonderful reforms that were, I'd say, visually very effective and easy to see. And when one day there was a bad police, and roughly another day there was good police. And there was a very nice slide that you have about a time for replenishment of those 100-day window. And now, actually, I have a feeling that all of those reforms that were, I mean, easy to see and fast to implement, there are no such room lack for those. And what we currently have is something that needs to be done for a long period of time, and it is very hard for the government to show immediate effects on that. And now, because of that, the people are not can actually see that, and what we maybe currently have is that people don't. They are not as happy with current government as they were about a 3 or 5 years ago. So, what would be your recommendation to the people and to the government? How we can widen that window, or how we can make what the government is currently making more effective or visually effective that can be seen easily and accepted easily.
No, I think you're absolutely right. I think you cannot keep on reforming at the same pace forever, because there's an agenda of reforms and that gets exhausted. So the low-hanging fruits, which is what you were referring to, some of the things that were much more visible and not necessarily easy to do, because many of the reforms that were done were very difficult to do. But now you are into another phase where maybe more advanced type of reforms are needed and might not have the same quick results as this circle might actually suggest. One of the areas which takes a long time to develop, which is really the development of the education potential and the skill potential of the country, because Georgia's asset at the end of the day is really in its people, because Georgia doesn't have oil, doesn't have huge mineral resources, doesn't have other natural endowments. Its natural endowment is all of you. And I think, you know, the reforms in the education sector which have begun, but I think, you know, a lot of the private investment in education that is taking place is absolutely important for developing the longer term skill potential of the country. But it takes time to show. It is, you cannot set up a university every month, you cannot bring out 10,000 skilled graduates every month, you know, that is not possible. So it is a slow process of actually developing, transforming the country. Some of the other reforms, for instance, I think, you know, a lot of what I call horizontal reforms have been taken. When you look at the business climate, etc., a lot of the horizontal reforms across the board have been taken. But now maybe it is time to go into some of the more vertical reforms, deep in specific sectors, which may be, have the highest growth potential. For instance, if we believe that agriculture is a sector with high growth potential, then we need to see what should be the role of the state, what the state should do or should not be doing in agriculture, much more closely. If we believe that mining is an area, or if we believe that tourism, or if we believe that the power sector is an area where of potential growth, then I think we need to look deeper into some of these areas. But I think in all of these areas, you will have a slower pace of change than some of these things that have happened in the past. So I think it's a natural evolution, because you cannot have the reform at the same. So I think, you know, the reform trajectory or at least the slope of that curve has reduced and will necessarily reduce. But there's a lot of other very important reforms that will take time to show for result. But that is a challenge for the political leadership also, in terms of being able to communicate. And that is why where the communication and the development of a common vision for the country becomes extremely important. But Kakham also wish to add on whether the cycle can still be continued.
No, that's interesting, because when I just came to Georgia, President asked me, so what do you think, is there a chance to move some reforms? I said, actually, there is a room like several months, like 6 months, 8 months maybe, after revolution, when there is a room for reforms. He said, no, but that, it was in the end of May, so he said, no, but it happens, and we've spent that 6 months without any serious reforms. So, well, let's think that when we reunite Algeria, it was the revolution, and let's count the 6 months from that. And it was one of the biggest interesting things is that this was continuing. I can tell you that, for example, when I resigned from government in February 2009, I was sure that there would be no reforms. But I was wrong, because there was lot of reforms after that, not huge amount, not so profound, but there was some really significant reforms, and the reforms are continuing till today. Of course, there is a problem. There is a problem is that what we call reforms, because I think that our understanding, your and my understanding are different, because I think that the reforms which are valuable are reforms which are enhancing individual liberty. And the World Bank calls reforms some other reforms also, which are decreasing individual liberty and imposing more regulation. From point of view of individual liberties, of course, a lot of things were done. There is some things which need to be done, and definitely after that, the bureaucratic system will begin to counter reform. It's unavoidable. Yeah. So the question is the pace of these counter reforms, which will be called reforms, like to improve previous reforms, yeah? For example, we don't have, or practically now don't have agricultural subsidies, and 5 years from now, we'll have some system of complicated formula-based farm subsidies, or something like that. Of course, that's bad, but that's unavoidable, because, I mean, there is only, more or less, there is only one country who more or less resist, I cannot say also it completely resist to this tendency of taking out the individual liberty, it's Singapore. Yeah, because Singapore, they made the reforms and then they practically stopped counter-reforming. Not completely, but practically in most of the areas they stopped reforming of medicine, counter reform. All other countries, they move through, they have some maximum of individual liberties, and after that there is distortion time, of course. Like it is happening in the United States, you can see now, like it was it happens in Europe, not happening now. For the Estonia is the good case. Estonia reached the maximum level of individual liberties in pre-accession period, and after that, despite the big resistance and that they postponed so-called EU-type reforms, of course they were implemented. Because now it's 14 years ago, 13 years ago, they accessed EU, and of course the level of individual liberty is much less. This was paid partially by EU money, but I mean that's why Estonia is so good development. But that's unavoidable. The nature of bureaucratic system. To cut that vicious circle, you need not virtuous circle, but vicious circle in this case. You need one more revolution, but it's not an answer, actually. And all revolution not means the forceful change of regime. Revolution like you have in the United States, like as a Tea Party, which I'm a big supporter and believer that they can change the situation in the United States. Yeah. So that's the reality we are living in. Most of the sectoral reforms, they are reducing liberties, yeah, and imposing more and more regulation. But we should not look to that to something as a sort of tragedy. Yeah.
Here is written, fighting corruption in public services, chronicling Georgia's reforms. And not chronicling Georgia's successful reforms. So I'm interested that if there is shown in this book some disadvantages of these reforms, because none of reforms can be ideal, I think, and all of them have some problems. And if it is shown in this book.
I think when you read the book in the case studies, you will see that that as some of the reforms were implemented, there were problems. In fact, it led to unintended consequences. There's a lot of experimentation that was done in Georgia, and CAFA knows a lot about it, in what we call also unconventional solutions. But there was a lot of corrections also. So they tried something in customs, it didn't work, you know, it led to long queues at the border, and traders started to protest that the government backed off, changed course, did something else. So I think we have a lot of that. There are big questions, for instance, also where a lot of people were laid off, right? A lot of policemen lost their jobs, a lot of people in the power sector lost their jobs. And there are questions on whether the way that the process was followed, was that due process, not due process? We don't go into those details, but there are questions. When you read it, there will be questions that you may have in your mind also about whether due process was followed in some areas or not. So what we are presenting here is not, we are not passing judgment on whether, you know, this was right or this was wrong. We are just documenting factually, in an evidence-based manner, in an objective manner, Georgia's story as we can read from the data and from the interviews with a lot of government officials. So it is uncensored story here. And I think you will find that there were various issues and problems that the government faced at different points in time in the implementation of these areas.
But in one word, it was successful or unsuccessful?
No, it is. I mean, overall, I think the story is a positive story. The story, otherwise, we wouldn't have written the story.
Story of success.
First of all, thank you for your positive presentation. In your book, as I see, you are talking about the successful reforms, but I think that during your writing books, you had to keep in touch with a lot of people and as well with a lot of problems. So how do you think aside from the successful reforms, what kind of problems we still have in the public sector, and what kind of reforms we need to overcome these problems. So I'm giving question about the rest of the problems we still have. If you can give me the answer. Thanks.
You're asking a much broader question. I think, as again, this book is really about fighting corruption in the public services. And I think the big question in my mind is on some of those areas that we cover in this book is really about sustainability. So it is still early in, you know, institutional development takes a long time, and it is still early in the day to actually be sure that the institutions that have been created, whether it is in the police service, whether it's in the tax service, etc., that will actually continue to perform with the same level of efficiency and cleanliness and, you know, and lack of corruption that that we have seen recently. And that is where the checks and balances come in, very important, and the strength of the institutions. So that keeps the accountability framework between the government, the providers of services, the citizens. So that framework becomes very important to apply. What we find is that, you know, it's like a glass half full, but also half empty. So a lot has been accomplished, but there's always more to be done, right? And that is the challenge for the government. Now, in a broader context of public sector reforms, what can happen to the economy, as the other lady also asked, you know, that is a much bigger question in terms of what the state should be doing or should not be doing. I think, you know, that is a much broader discussion. Maybe Kaka can invite me some other time to have that discussion.
And I think that the public sector in Georgia is not reformed as a sector, and as public sector management is not reformed completely. But in reality, of course, what we have today is one of the most deep public sector management reforms. I think that it's, of course, Singapore is most deep, and New Zealand maybe is comparable today. It's more advanced, but I think that we are going to that structure, very far from German style, military based public sector management. And from that point of view, of course, there is a lot of things to be done. And one of the biggest problems, I think, is public sector management is the recruitment policies. Which makes me very unhappy that there is, despite a lot of efforts, we were unable to change in general, because there's some big improvements, but to change in general that people are moving from one service to another, is the so-called teams, when new minister is appointed, he tried to change everyone in the ministry, at least on the top positions, and there is a lot of relatives in hired, so that is very, very ugly, very, very, very ugly face of unreformed that part. Yeah, I think that it needs another mini revolution in public sector to clean it from this old nepotism and clientele and relative hiring approaches, and to build it based on, like, in efficient and competitive private sector. It can be. That's the problem not only of our public sector, it's the same problem we have in private sector. Yeah. For example, one friend of mine, owner of quite big business. He is building some new business, and I found that there is no single person which is not his relative or his wife's relative or his friend's relative. Yeah, they're called friend's relative. So I think that's the road to non-success. And in Free University and in Agrarian University, we have a very clear policy that neighbors are not working with us. Yeah, we have some cops working maybe independently good people, but we offered them, one of them, to leave the university. It was not really easy decision, but that's okay. So we need to fight that part, and that is one of the worst things we have in public sector, and that needs to be curbed. But I cannot see that how it can happen quickly, because there is a lot of things to do: political cycles, elections this year, elections next year, local elections the year after that. But we should find a solution from this.
Maybe it is time for you to do another stint in government to clean that up. But I think Kahar is a very important point, actually, of the professionalization of the public sector. It reminds me also, in the private sector, it reminds me there's a, in India also we have the same problem where companies actually grew initially as family companies. And now only, for instance, one of the biggest Indian company names is the Tatas. And for generations, this has been for several generations, it has always been in the family name. There has always been a Tata at the head of the company. And it was only now that the current head has said that his successor is not going to be a Tata, but a professional appointee. There is a generational change. I think it's an evolutionary process also in terms of how private companies also. There's another Indian company by the name of Infosys. Two partners opened it up, but right from day one, they had an agreement that none of their children or their relatives would ever work in that company. And in fact, both of them have children. They're all Harvard-educated, Stanford-educated, MBAs and all, top-notch professionals. They have set up their own companies, but none of them work in their companies. And they also now have had a succession to a completely new professional management. So I think there's a lot to be said, actually, for that culture of professional management. And I think, hopefully, I think in Georgia also, I think it will grow faster rather than slower.
How do you think, which countries can take this model of the corruption and especially from the South Union countries?
But we had a lot of interest, actually. The other day I had a video conference with the Kyrgyz Republic. The Deputy Prime Minister of Kyrgyzstan wanted to learn about it, and we're trying to see how we can actually make it happen, help them also. This book has now been translated into Russian as well as in Ukrainian. I think those versions will also be on the web. And there are several other countries, including in Ukraine, where there is an interest of learning from the Georgian experience and trying to apply it there. But we are getting interest in learning from the Georgian experience, even from countries in Africa, for instance, and in Middle East, and from some of the Arab Spring countries. So we'll see. One can't push these reforms. I think this is something that has to come from within those countries, and that that is, in some ways, that is what is meant also by political will. I mean, it has to be homegrown. This is not something that can be imposed from outside. So, those countries that are interested in improving and providing greater, liberties within and to open up their space to enable an improvement in public services, etc. I think that will they can actually learn and take the reforms forward. So there are many other countries where I know, we have sent the copies of the book and it's available for free downloads on our website. But I know that the book is being circulated quite widely now.
It's interesting that actually, for example, Russia is very carefully looking to Georgia reforms, and it's not well-known fact, but for example, in 2010 and 11, there was at least three group of experts coming from Russia to learn more about our police reform. And unfortunately for Russia, nothing happens because they just take only some superficial features of reform, not doing nothing deep. But in general, there is big interest in all countries.
So 3 weeks ago, we had a team from Tajikistan, right, looking at e-government and public service and civil service registry improvements. So that was 3 weeks ago.
But most of them, they are not looking to a holistic approach. Actually, for example, our university, we are advising the government of Rwanda in Central Africa. I personally was involved in advising, and we help a lot in some cases with government of Ukraine and some others, but actually the only country who is trying now, if they can do that, that's a big question, who is trying to do this holistic approach in Kyrgyzstan. Because the situation in Kyrgyzstan is extremely, extremely bad. Country is very poor, swan in corruption, and the only chance they can have is to change things. And this new prime minister, Baba is very energetic, and he can really do change things, I hope. But all other countries are trying to take some parts of the reform, like Ukrainians take our bankruptcy law and copy it, construction permits requirements, something like that. That's piecemeal is also good. I mean, if we can improve life of your citizens, why not to do that on a piecemeal basis? But the real success will be only if you have a holistic approach.
Firstly, thank you for interesting speech and this book. I'm interested in are you going to write another book, another part of reforms about Georgia's international relationship or something else?
I don't think I'm going to write any other book anytime soon. So maybe you should write. I think it's time for a Georgian to write a good book about Georgia's future. So,
again, I have one more question. Now, when we are talking about corruption, we can talk about two kinds of corruption. Lower and some people call elite corruption. Nowadays in Georgia, everybody is agreed that on lower level there are no more corruption. But how do you think personally? It's your personal question. What can you say to the people who claims that in Georgia we have huge elite corruption? And for example, to compare with our neighbor countries, we can say that percent of our neighbor countries' corruption is much higher than Georgians, but the result of this corruption in Georgian's case is twice or three more times bigger. So what can you say about, what can you answer to these people who claim this? What about elite corruption?
This book, this book is about both elite corruption as well as, one of the success stories, for instance, on the tax collection was really, this whole nexus between the thieves in law and the government. That was state capture, right? That was state capture by corrupt elements. And I think that was defeated, right? I think that is everyone accepts that. So I think in this book, we are talking both about what you refer to as the lower level corruption, but also some aspects of the high level corruption, which especially in tax and customs and in the police reforms. There was what we try to capture is how this pyramid of corruption that existed in 2003, how that has been broken, right? The whole pyramid has been. Now, is there elite corruption? Your guess is as good as mine. I don't have a view on that because I don't have any evidence one way or the other. President Saakashvili was in Washington. He was asked this question and he said it was bullshit. Any accusation, this was exactly his word. It is on national television, so I can say that. So there's no evidence of that, on that. And if there was evidence, then it is something that should be an issue of concern. But you hear stories. 3 months ago there was a deputy minister of health who was fired. So I don't know, what even the definition of elite corruption is not clear. So is there corruption at different parts of government still? Of course there is. No government and no country is absolutely free of corruption. And there will be in the private sector, in the public sector, there will always be some level of corruption. And the fight on corruption has to be a continuous one. So it's this is something that you as citizens have to exercise your rights and then make sure that in a libertarian world that you are free to speak, that you exercise, that you engage vigorously in debates in public policy. You ask, seek information, you seek transparency in public accounts, and then you make your voice heard. And I think that is the best guarantee that there will be no return to the practices of the past.
And responsible. And that, I think, we can close the discussion after that. It's my favorite question, and I cannot stay neutral, not answering, because I think that it's a very good interaction, actually, the political interaction, to say that there is a little corruption, because by definition it's a corruption which cannot be founded. It cannot be identified. There is lots of interesting things coming from the idea of corruption. But first of all, let's do sectoral. Yeah? Does we have elite corruption in tax collection? Yeah? Is we are collecting the amount of taxes which is equal to what the tax rates are practically. So there is very small difference. So the compliance is very, very high. Yeah? So it looks like that there cannot be elite corruption as it is. So there can be some one case or two cases of corruption, but there cannot be established case of elite corruption, because otherwise our tax collection would be much lower. So let's go to electricity sector. Is there an elite corruption? Can there be elite corruption in the electricity sector? And how we can imagine it? So what's the elite corruption in the electricity sector? Yeah? And nobody can answer on that what can be that. I know what was the corruption in the electricity sector in 2003 and 2004, yeah? And before that also. What is the corruption today? No, I cannot understand. Can we talk about elite corruption in, for example, educational system, that an admission, for example? No. It's impossible to imagine how it can work, yeah? So and so on, going from one sector to another sector, you can find that there is no room for any type of corruption or elite corruption. So if there is a corruption, it should be small, yeah, anyway. That's one part of the answer. And second comes from the lot of research about what is the corruption in general. And so actually, all the research which was done, for example, about corporate corruption in the United States, and there's a lot of cases, yeah, that people within corporations, private corporations, were taking bribes, stealing money, etc., shows that elite corruption in general is impossible. Not in Georgia, but anywhere it's impossible, because that means that you should have some strata and some sharp margin between who are corrupt and who are not corrupt. And you should have people who are directly working as subordinates of the corrupted people, not founding that they are corrupted, yeah? So they are doing these corruptions in a way which is, unrecognizable for their direct subordinates, yeah? Because if they found that they are corrupted, they also want to have to be corrupted, yeah? And so it's like an infection. It goes very rapidly, goes to the bottom, so. And none of these private corporate corruption cases were described when you can have established, sustainable, corrupt circle on the top, and there was everything clean down. Yeah, because it's against human nature, because human beings are involved in corruption when they want to make more, earn more money. There is no control, and they think that the corruption is within the established norms of morale. Yeah? If you have your bosses are corrupted, you will go to corruption immediately. It's 100% response of any normal human being. Yeah. So, and I think that in Georgia's case it's the same. Of course, there is corruption which happens in different levels. We know that there is some. For example, there was in last 1 year, there was one prosecutor arrested, there was a deputy head of a local government arrested. There was deputy minister. It was earlier. And of course that type of things will happen. Yeah, because fighting against corruption is like fighting against infection. Yeah, you cannot create infection-free environment. You can create environment when you are fighting infection permanently, and that's reducing the chance to be infected seriously. Yeah, so that's what I want about elite corruption, and I want to thank our guest once more. Thank you.